African Climate Talks is an initiative of the African Climate Policy Center and the Climate for Development in Africa, CLIMDEV initiative, which is a Pan-African initiative of the UNECA, the African Development Bank, and the African Union Commission. And it is a series of interconnected sub-regional and Africa-wide events which seek to define an African climate change narrative and to further build confidence and consensus around key issues in climate science, climate policy, and climate governance. Africa,
on behalf of Addis Ababa University and myself, I'm happy to welcome you to all to the high-level second African climate talks aimed towards contributing to the Talanoa Dialogue. Addis Ababa University, being the oldest and the largest in Ethiopia, has repositioned itself to be able to contribute its share in the development endeavor in the country in various sectors. With a vision to be among the 10 preeminent African research universities by 2025.
The aim of the African Climate Talks is to stimulate a wide-ranging discourse informed by the emerging African common positions on a range of pertinent issues, and to also create platforms for the discussion of African perspectives on key issues in the linkages between climate change and Africa's transformative development trajectories. ACT will enhance public awareness of climate change, its implications, challenges, and opportunities for Africa, and facilitate critical reflection on the global dynamics of climate governance and the possible implications of these for Agenda 2063, but of course also for the Sustainable Development Goals.
Ask yourself, what financial flows are consistent with the reality of a continent that lives under 3 to 4 degrees Celsius? What food production system would you have? What poverty reduction agenda could you have under those circumstances? And what sustainable development processes under such existential threat?
We must be proud of the current crop of negotiators that we have from around the continent. They've been very active. They have been dynamic in most ways, and I believe they've been very good spokespersons for Africa in the negotiating process. As we speak, I've just learned that negotiators from the least developed countries are also meeting here in Addis, preparing for the next session of the UNFCCC subsidiary bodies, which begin at the end of next month in Bonn.
The UNFCCC and the WTO must be in the same WhatsApp group. That is the topic of the work that I'm doing now. To say we've seen that they are not in the same WhatsApp group, and as such, there's this juncture in terms of what they are presenting in terms of the agreement on agriculture. And I think this is a good platform for us to start bringing these people together in the negotiations.
That African countries do not go as a team. They go individually. Yet, when you look at African countries, they don't have the same capacities. They have different expertise, different economic specialization. They have different financial incentives they receive from the global partners. And their priorities during negotiation are also different based on the magnitude of environmental impacts. And finally, their attitude and behavior during past negotiations are also different. So when they go as individuals, generally they are likely to lose.
What we think is that if countries, developing countries, are not supported all the way to the end, from step one to step three of Red Plus, it is hard to achieve goals of Red Plus globally and at national scale.
So if Red Plus has done anything in communities at all, it is that it has raised awareness on the importance of carbon forestry, the importance of the forests know, in addressing climate change, reducing emission. But in most cases, I would say, from investigation going on the ground, it's been found that participation of communities especially has been very tokenistic and in most cases very instrumental. And there have been human rights abuses, in many REDD+ projects. Despite the fact that safeguards have been put in place at a global level.
We need to think about governance of nature, governance of climate, in the context of who's benefiting from the shifting regimes of climate governance. So for me, the big question is, how do we as individual societies, as countries, and as a global society, we negotiate these different kinds of goals and sometimes the apparently competing agendas of social justice, environmental protection, climate governance, economic development? What kind of processes actually feed into informing our decision-making processes about governance strategies and so forth? And if we look at it from that kind of a broad lens, what do we learn by thinking comparatively about these outcomes in different societies?
Is to establish a continental platform, much like this one, where communities or states, they have this ability to share knowledge on indigenous knowledge systems, how communities are experiencing or using their local knowledge in the context of their economies, their cultural context, and so forth. How are they doing it? Can we have a platform as a continent where we can have that shared knowledge?
For me, what is fundamental is we need to learn to build on existing practices and see what works. For example, what is now called green technologies and so on, particularly in the habitat construction, which is often missing in our talks about climate-related issues. There are a lot of technologies across many African cultures which have been proven to be resilient and yet environmentally friendly, and their footprint is much greener.
So we need to also to demonstrate what we can offer as a continent to the global systems, and we have a lot. Our own human generated resources, that is our knowledge, undergirded by the natural resources. So easy for us to simply go and say we have the largest deposits of lithium and platinum and gold and so on. That's fine. We do. But if you go by the archaeological history, we also have the knowledge that has been accumulated more than all other parts of the human race. And there we think that it's all lost. Where to? We can no longer just come to panels like this one to illustrate how IAKS work. No. Much still needs to be done, but we now need action.
Right now, the negotiations are around the sectoral approaches. My proposal is, as we go forward, let us steer the negotiations, the climate change negotiations, into the focus on outcomes. What are these outcomes? Poverty. Because if we can address poverty, we have solved a lot of issues, livelihood issues. It is around vulnerability, human security, food security, water security, all of those security around the human being, instead of agriculture, water, health.
So why do we need climate resilient infrastructure on the continent? We have a huge deficit of infrastructure, but there's a huge demand for infrastructure on the continent. And so that gives us a challenge. The challenge is that how can we quickly provide so much infrastructure to meet the demand quickly, but at the same time do it in a way that is climate resilient and cost effective. So we have the opportunity to build our infrastructure so that it can perform very well into the future. We don't have to retrofit resilience and so on, unlike other places where they already have most of the infrastructure that they need. Globally, more than 50% of the infrastructure that will be needed by 2050 is not yet built, and most of that is in Africa. So we have the opportunity to do it right.
The Talanoa Dialogue of this year is really the first step of trying to deal with how do we assess our collective progress towards 1.5 degrees, the next stage being that in 2023 there will be there will be a global stocktake. But before that, countries also have an opportunity to revise their NDCs by 2020, either resubmit the NDCs as they are, or revise or produce totally new ones.
The initiative itself, for those that might not be aware, is based on four pillars. The first pillar talks to enhancing climate information services, the issue that we talked about yesterday as well. The second pillar is about strengthening policy and institutional framework. The third one being supporting concrete on the ground, concrete action on the ground, that is implementation, pure implementation on the ground. And the fourth one is climate finance and investment. So those are the four pillars. When anybody asks you what is Africa Adaptation Initiative, it is that initiative that aim to enhance action on the ground, and is made up of four pillars.
One thing we have to look at, which we've always like jumped over it, is why are we experts having a challenge of self-esteem? We seem to be too shy to go and seek political elective positions, and we allow rascals to indonate our parliaments. This is very clear when you see the guys battering themselves with chairs in Ugandan parliament and in Nigeria and Cameroon. What does this tell you? This tells you that there is a vacancy somewhere. And then again, how can you effectively promote and consolidate IKASs when, after all these discussions and technical paper production, we are going to carry them like a begging bowl in front of politicians who are just having they barely know what climate change is, they barely know what climate adaptation is, they barely know what climate mitigation is.
We need to go to the national level and identify this critical mass of agents. And for me, they are the majority who are the youth. They are the ones who have suffered most from the development path they've taken, and the women. But how are we going to mobilize them? What are we going to do to mobilize them? We need to identify the structures and the processes, and it has to be persistent or consistent. They have to be part of the process, like I've said, they have to be part of the negotiators, they have to be part of the decision makers, they have to be part of the process that engages our governments.
We need to start including the youth, we need to start training them on key issues that Africa should start talking about. For example, mitigation plus adaptation. It's not only adaptation, but we also have to look at mitigation too. We need to know these key issues. Can we ask and we seek for the support of ACPC, AFDB, AU, and all the regional organizations to please come together and help us achieve this dream of being part of the next station, being part of decision making, and helping to make Africa a better place. Thank you.
If you all want the African youth to be a leader, leaders for the future, and you want actually to see a UNFCCC president who's from Africa, and you also want to see different strategies and different thoughts, different ideas, then we are the solution.
Mm-hmm.